so happens we've we're part of the Liverpool City region and have bid for a skills broker. So we've been asking for our own dedicated skills broker, going into our businesses to understand, one, the shortage of skills, but also high on that agenda is apprenticeships. So from the 1st of April, we'll have our own skills broker going in and working with our businesses to understand what's been the barrier to those apprenticeships. Why aren't more of our businesses employing apprentices? We work, you know, really well with Wirral College. So we need to understand and start to drill down fully what has been the barrier to, for those businesses to employ young people. Well, it's not just young people, it's apprentices, full stop, isn't it, at any age. Yeah. But hopefully, having our own dedicated, which we've never had before, having our own dedicated skills broker in Wirral, I feel is starting to, maybe to identify some of those issues.
Thanks, Hi, Paula. Just looking at the figures there under our contract delivery, and you've put 2,174 as a figure for jobs created, which is, commendable. It's also quite a big claim, so how can you substantiate those exact figures in relation to the direct involvement from yourselves in actually creating that? But secondly, how many of those jobs percentage-wise actually are in continuation now and actually still exist?
So the first question, Tony, so we have a CRM system and every single business that we have contact with or we support, and these jobs are through support, not just contact or engagement. These are actual businesses that we've supported that have had a project, or that we've given 12 hours, 24 hours assist, because that's the support we give. So every single one of those businesses are on our CRM, and we write to them. So we've got, of those 2,103 jobs, or whatever it is, every single business has confirmed they've either safeguarded or created those jobs. So if you want to come over to us at Action House, I'll happily sift through that information for you, and we can go through. But no, seriously, all the businesses have confirmed, every single one that we've directly supported through this contract has created those jobs. Secondly, those jobs still around from when we started this back in 3 years ago. We still go back to those businesses and ask them, have they still got that retention? And what we've come back with is that figure goes up and down throughout the quarter that we start to record on. So it's a big piece of work if you want us to go back to every single business and ask them how many jobs they've created and are people still in that employment. Happy to do it if you want to pay us.
I don't think I'm in that position to sign that check for you, but if I would, I'd love to, but and I think I'll take it on face value for the information to give me. Yeah, definitely come and see you then.
Yeah. Hi, Paula. Yeah, the model I've been really enthused by, and hopefully was, you know, part of, was what we've done at Woodside Ferry. I think that's an absolute gem. I don't know if anyone's been there, but it's small food restaurants, outlets, bars, and it gives them a foothold to start in business, and as they develop clientele, we leave there and open. So we've seen the first restaurant move into Heswell,
yep.
The Thai restaurant, yep. Sort of town, is it?
Yep.
And I just think that model could work in so many other ways. You know, so small engineering business, we give them a small premise in a cluster, we work together, we get profit, they move, and the next one comes in. So the thing is, I'm enthused by the model. Are there any other examples or any proposals to advance that model elsewhere, because I think it's a destination now, Woodside, it's become a destination, and I see it being repeated elsewhere, maybe not rebecca in a market type style way forward. So I just wonder what's in the pipeline or that model being expanded to other parts.
Yeah, I think for Woodside, so we took a terminal, didn't we, at Woodside, that wasn't fit for purpose, and we managed to get funding from all various sources. and we, as you said, Steve, we're growing those businesses, so they come in and they've got a round office, a kitchen and running water and everything. We work with them, and then obviously, as you just said, a couple of those businesses will move out and move into their own premises, and that's what we want. And I referred to that in the presentation. So the likes of Edgerton House is no longer fit for purpose. What do we need to do? Because if you were building an incubator space, you would only build offices for up to 6 or 10 people. Edgerton House has got big offices in there up to 50 people, so what do we want to do with that? We repurpose it, provide the support, that wraparound support that the Chamber can give, and then we grow those businesses, and as I was referring to before, with our growth plans on Wirral, we're going to be building more and more office space. Who's going to start filling them? That, for me, is one of the Chamber's roles, is we need to be identifying businesses that have the potential to grow, work with those businesses, with that incubator, in the incubator space, with that wraparound support, and then move them into their own premises. How do we do more of that? And that's the question. And it's not only, for me, Edgerton House should be digital and tech. What about the other sectors that we're working with? So to me, we have the model. What we now need to start looking at is where's the resource and do we have buildings that we can do that? And I know there are some, you know, look at make Wirral, make Hamilton Square. They've taken a building and started to support artists and creative companies. Pacific Road, a classic example. We refurbished that, didn't we, 3 years ago. We had 25 businesses in there, and those businesses we helped to grow and move on. So we had a business startup that started with 3 jobs. They're now in Edgerton House and they're employing 15 staff. They will have the potential to grow to 25, 30 staff. Where are they going to go? Well, I'm hoping we're going to build some more space and we can start filling that space with our businesses.
Well, finally, I can subscribe to the magazine today. I don't know whether members know that. There's a you've got a digital magazine that's been out to subscribe today. I'd like to say thank you for the full-page article on Tamashan Tafar, which is a great book, and hopefully we'll get sponsorship in through that, so thank you for that.
Thanks, Paul, building on from your last comments to, I think it was mostly Steve, it seems a bit of a no-brainer to me. The local authority has a number of council buildings that are either empty or almost empty. Surely the local authority, and I'm looking for some guidance from one of the directors, surely the local authority is looking to identify buildings that could be used for the benefit of the businesses that Cllr is supporting, and also bringing money for us. Can we have some confirmation of that, please, or can you tell us what we're doing?
I think just to start, Chair, as a principle, I think Cllr referred to Pacific Road. I think that's the textbook example of what we've done so far. Clearly it was once a council theatre. We overcame the practical difficulties of the tram power station being in there, the tram track going through it, and I think it's been a real success. I think we do look at other buildings. Cllr referred to the empty finance municipal, the stump of the former multi-storey tower, which it took us a while to get there because there was still some equipment in there, IT equipment in the server room, but we've got the groups in there now, the IT, the media, and the startup in there. We do continue to look at other buildings. We need to work with the Chamber and identify other buildings that can be used either into the future indefinitely or can be used for a few years until they need to be repurposed. Principle is established, you're right, we just need to keep bringing the program.
Okay.
So just to build on what Dave said, but we are working in the Chamber, so the jigsaw is the engaged chairman, which is the combined authority you've got. So, the council got the buildings, the chamber would have that model. How do we access some of that money for growth? It would go direct into businesses. So how do we put that tripartite together to get more of our business space and more? So that's something we're working on now. We've got bits in, or the Chamber got bits in, we've still got obviously a support on that.
Geoffrey,
the
next point.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it was just on Steve's comment, and it's for Al and for Paul as well, on clusters, so obviously one in engineering itself and obviously works in manufacturing. But clusters, whilst you're saying that the small businesses that are moving into an area with clusters because it's actually a good start-up area for them, fantastic. But they tend to want to stay in those areas, so rather than, and I know you're saying they're moving into their own premises and branching out, but this is something that we spoke about years ago now, when Wallasey was first spoken about probably back in 2011, 2012. And at that point in time, I know there was a lot of talk around first and second tier automotive suppliers potentially being interested. Obviously, it's not come to fruition at this point in time. But going forward, is that something we're looking at? And with the chamber, that would actually, it ties into our local plan as well, doesn't it? That we actually have to have the development commercial developments available for them to actually move into. But that's something we should be looking at, not just distribution centres, but actual manufacturing centres, that we can entice them into the early high paid jobs. Is that something you're working with?
Yeah, there's a number of projects we're working on, so I'll let Paul talk about business forums, which are key components to get businesses working together in a cluster type approach, which is part of the contract that we have for our chamber. But we are working with other organisations as well alongside the chamber, so Amazing Maritime, who are the organisation who, as you know, lead on maritime development, but all those associated sectors around clean technologies and other advanced manufacturing. So we are working in partnership, and there's maritime knowledge of the world is clustering of those maritime businesses. That is absolutely foremost in our minds, but the other sectors as well, so not to forget construction, and how if we get those construction businesses working together, we can get more local value out of supply chains, particularly if the big developments now start to move forward. And then you'll want also even reference this digital. When you've got an area in close proximity to the city centre where we've got the space that we have, it's no brainer for some of those businesses who want space you want to be in a different location, so I think we've got a real market for digital businesses as well.
Yeah, I think just touching on the supply chain, because we want to keep that world pound and world, don't we? But what we're trying to do is we've set up through the contract six sectors forums who meet on a quarterly basis, and that's we have attendance of anything from 80 to 120 businesses each time. Well, there's 24 sector forums, so six sector forums we meet quarterly. But if we started the sector forums where it was specifically for that sector, we've moved on from then, and the sector's now saying, well, can we start to network with different sectors then? And we're starting to see partnerships, collaboration, and also supply chains, because some businesses actually, although we would think businesses know each other, they actually don't. So how do we encourage the networking and through the sector forums we have? What we now start to, we need to do, and I referred to it in the presentation, we've got that business intelligence now. What we need to be doing is getting our businesses to collaborate, and certainly with contracts coming forward and the construction, we know some of our smaller businesses, quite a lot of our smaller construction businesses will never be able to tender because they don't have all the policies in place, but they could do they can subcontract. But how do we bring quite a few of our contractors together where they could be eligible to get to bid for a bigger contract? It doesn't always have to be outside the area. How do we retain and how do we look after our supply chain for our local businesses as well?
Paul, your first slide, you showed the percentage locations of membership across the four rural constituencies. I found myself adding the figures up until you got to 84, so where were the other 16, please?
So the other 16% are outside of Wirral. So we've got Chester, Ellesmere, Portland, and Poole. So we have members outside of Wirral as well that are also Wirral Chamber members.
We've got
about too many in
there. Go on. Thanks. We've also mentioned new enterprises created, and new enterprises sustained.
Yeah.
New enterprises 210, and that 12 months is 112. And bearing in mind, evidence has shown most small companies or ordinary companies go bust within 2 years.
Yeah.
How many are 112?
again, it's having this thought through the contract, but it's also we're part of a Liverpool City region partnership as well, where we also have financial support and resource to really intensively support those businesses. So the Wirral Council contract, we can support businesses up to 2 years, and then with the Liverpool City Region contract, we can support businesses 2 years and beyond. So we have a dedicated team through the resource of the council and the Liverpool City Region. We have 5 staff who work on our business start team. But not only that, what we've started to do is do peer-to-peer mentoring. So when we have workshops for our established businesses, we're saying to our business staffs who have been operating for 6-12 months, come and join us. Let's share best practice. Let's get in touch with the businesses that are established in Wirral. And for us, and businesses do go, we do see a lot of money. We see quite a few businesses that have set up and then within 12 months, 2 years, they don't exist anymore. And that's why it's important from the outset is to have that business plan, not only in their head, because a lot of the time we start to talk to an individual and they want to set up a business, and you know straight away it's certainly not viable and it's not sustainable as well. So it's really steering them down into another route, but you can't always do that. And that's why, you know, someone has an idea, someone has a dream, and they want to set up their own business. But it won't be sustainable. And we say that to them, but they still do it. But the ones that we do support, we give them intensive support. So we don't just let them set up a business and write a business plan. It's not about that. It's about giving them that intensive support that maybe if we have an FD from one of our large businesses, that they will go in and they will support them. And it's all about wanting to receive that support and not just in 18 months or 2 years' time when you are struggling, then you bring us in. It's having that constant contact all the time. That's where I'm putting it down to. We do give all of our businesses the support that they need. And we have a good rate of survival.
Surely politician
Paul,
how many of them as well?
I'm sorry. I'll get back to you on that, of course.
Thanks very much for your report. I used to be a co-op business advisor for 27 years before politics opened every aspect of my life. And I was just wondering if you could drill down a bit into the figures and talk about the types of businesses that you support and the like democratic businesses, co-op mutuals. Can you give any examples?
So, we, as I said at the beginning, we'll support any business that needs that support. So what kind of businesses? So it's anything from the business start, one man band, up to the likes of Typhoon, and anything in the, around the governance and what the structure is for businesses. So company limited by guarantee, community interest companies, social enterprises, private companies. So we basically offer support to any organisation that needs that support. But if you want us to do detail, we can't give the names of our businesses, but we can certainly drill down on the detail of what sectors they're in and also the legal status of those businesses as well.
I read a piece today, going back to the City Region Growth Platform news letter that came. You're involved in the piece where they're actually sending business people into schools, hoping to improve the skill force that we require for the future.
So, where the Growth Hub for Wirral, so part of the Growth Platform, each area has a Growth Hub partner. Wirral Chamber is the Growth Hub partner for Wirral. Just on going into schools, Dave, we are also a Wirral Chamber, and we go into schools, so we engage with 22 of the secondary schools, and we also provide support for teachers going into industry so they can teach our children to understand what sectors are out there, what kind of businesses are out there. So we have teacher days that go into industry, and for us it's about bringing industry and education together, how we're doing that, and that's bringing our businesses into schools and presenting, and it's not always about academia. So I know one of our IT companies, they recruit young people who have difficulties in learning, but maybe very, very good at working out things. So the likes of coding, you need to be sitting there all the time and concentrating. That's not for everyone, but it doesn't mean you've got to be great at maths and great at English. It just means you need to have that capability to keep having a go and trying to unlock things. So for us, it's about the businesses going into the schools and helping the young people understand what careers they do want. If they don't want to do further or higher education, they can do the apprenticeships, and that's what we need to do more of. So we've got Young Chamber engaging with the 22 secondary schools and also engaging with six junior schools as well.
Thank you very much. Really comprehensive response to all questions. Thank you. The recommendation is enough background information to business support service contract in relation to the service provided in preparation for accreditation to supply of the petition. Agree to that recommendation? Thank you very much indeed. Next one is item six, runs on from that, it's the impact of the pensions.
Businesses paying the apprenticeship levy, whether or not they were actually taking apprentices as a result of paying that levy, but also how a levy has impacted on adult learning opportunities. So, in terms of report summary, while you requested that particular information to around local businesses that pay levy and the impact of levy. And apprenticeships. Unfortunately, that information is not in the public domain, both on a sort of local level but also on a national level in terms of the impact of the levy. So what I have done is I've given you sort of further information, done some analysis around apprenticeship participation per se across Wirral and the Liverpool City region for comparison purposes. I can also state as well, in terms of Wirral and across the city region, there has been no negative impact in terms of adult learning in relation to the apprenticeship levy. So I can confirm, as head of service for the council's adult learning service, lifelong learning service, we are at a profile in terms of our delivery perspective. Numbers of enrolments on programmes, and the college is over profile in terms of its adults and all learning programmes. So locally, I don't believe that there are any particular issues relating to adult learning. So recommendations are that you as the committee note the report, but also you support further close working with our employers, including the Chamber of Commerce, Wirral College and other local training providers, the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority as our key funder of the adult education budget, and agree the objectives to increase uptake of apprenticeships and maximise use of the apprenticeship levy. In terms of reasons for the recommendations, you've already identified that there has been quite a significant reduction over the last 2 years. In terms of apprenticeship participation, particularly around young people. Globally, we've had a 9% reduction in apprenticeships between 2018 and 2019. The biggest impact's been on young people at 27%. And it's a very, very complex picture. I think a lot of it's linked to national policy. people that are local as well. So in terms of some of the national changes, we've got changes from what are called apprenticeship frameworks into apprenticeship standards, and then the sort of key components linked to apprenticeships. Apprenticeship standards have included the removal of some level 2 opportunities for young people and continue to move forward in that way. Level 2 opportunities have been a key entry point for young people into apprenticeship learning, so you could almost see that as a barrier going forward in terms of those developments. Also, standards include things called endpoint assessments, so young people that traditionally maybe not enjoyed their experience around GCSE examinations and those linear type examinations will now have to sit an endpoint assessment test, which is a formal test, at the end of their apprenticeships to complete the process and accreditation for that. Locally, intelligence from firms is that apprenticeships and apprenticeship funding now, particularly through that for those paying the levy, is that it's been predominantly being used for their full workforce development opportunities, not necessarily more traditional apprenticeship routes. So for those that are choosing to invest more in high level skills, so it might be more managerial leadership type qualifications that can now be funded through levy. Non-levy employers, so those small to medium enterprises. Again, some of the barriers, I think, for small to medium enterprises has been around the 20% off the job reform that's come through around apprenticeships. So for every person that enrolls in an apprenticeship, they're expected to spend at least one day a week of their 5-day week off the job undertaking apprenticeship training. That can be done in a variety of ways, but quite often it involves them attending a training provider or the college. So that's unfortunately quite negative, but there are quite a number of changes in there that unfortunately are national changes. The cumulative effect, then, if I take you to paragraph 1.8, the cumulative effect of the four factors, then, is the 35% reduction in the numbers of apprenticeships. That's between 2017 and 2018. It's not been that significant between 18 and 19, but there still has been a significant fall. But this is not just a real reduction in apprenticeship participation. It is a national issue, but it's also a Liverpool City region issue in terms of reduction. Wirral, as I say, has seen a more significant reduction in 2018-2019, and there have been a number of causes around that. Wirral Met College, as the most significant provider of apprenticeship training, hasn't had funding for a period of 6 months during 2019, which did lead to a stall in opportunities for young people and adults. So, I've detailed there in paragraph 1.12 the number of potential changes or solutions that could be implemented that may impact more positively on apprenticeship participation. But I am aware also that as of this month, there have been some changes made by the Education Skills Funding Agency around their digital service. HMRC, whilst recognising that there is the potential for insufficient funding within the national funding system for small to medium-sized enterprises, is pump-priming and providing additional funding for the first quarter of this year. So the digital service for the first time is going to be open now for small to medium-sized enterprises to access, which alleviates some of the contracting and funding barriers that the likes of Royal Met College have experienced in 2019. And really starts to open up the market. There was some testing and trialing of the digital service last year for small to medium-sized enterprises, so there's been some lessons learned there, and we're expecting the go-ahead now in the next 2 weeks.
entirely agree with the scope of the report and the two recommendations that are contained within it, but I think reading and listening to what the officer was saying about where this, it's going, what is happening with many employers, they're using the apprenticeship levy to actually advance people internally. So they're doing, you know, they're upskilling people within the workforce. Now, I suppose one could argue as they move up the organisation, people will backfill. But clearly, by the government's own target, the numbers of 3 million are not going to be reached by 2020. So it isn't working quite correctly. Well, it isn't working properly as it is. We all believe that apprenticeship should be aimed if you don't get work at, particularly at, you know, the first level. So leaving school or under the age of 25, one would associate with apprenticeship. We have apprentices now who are in their 50s and 60s, which isn't what I believe to be the real thrust of the legislation. And where we have got control of that, possibly, as most people know now, that Liverpool City Region is in control of adults' education and skills and so on, where we've been able to get that levy off the employee and into their pockets, then they make good use of it and they make great advances. So my view, and it's not meant as a political swipe in any way, shape or form, and the way they increase loss, that we could ask the government as a their recommendation to have a re-look at it, to talk to businesses, to talk to governments, local governments, and to just have a little review of where they can tweak or, you know, fundamentally alter the offer. So I have got a formal way that would associate as item 3, and it's meant to be as politically set out as possible. If you are happy to hear the words,
please.
Okay, so it'd be additional item 3. We recognise there's been a huge reduction in the apprenticeship take-up since government introduced the apprenticeship levy scheme. The 3 million new apprenticeship figure by 2020 will not be reached by a long way. We ask government to revisit the apprenticeship levy scheme and set up a consultation with private and public sector businesses to make sure that the right schools support the introduction of new apprenticeships, particularly at level 2 and 3. That is not to say we do not value higher apprenticeship opportunities and the development of the existing workforce right up to degree level. It's also important that there is a pathway to level 2 apprenticeships for people who have not yet got to level 2 attainment level, as yet, including training and financial support within the workplace setting, adhering to the TUC apprenticeship charter. We also recognise the great work achieved by the Liverpool City Region in facilitating the unspent apprenticeship levy being channelled into SME organisations who are not subject to the apprenticeship levy. This has helped to give people skills and employment that they would not have normally got. So it's basically saying we have a report here that says it isn't delivering what it was promised to deliver. It's delivered in a different way than anticipated. I don't think government done that with any malice or at all. It's just not working the way we want it to. I think one of the roles of this committee is to feed into the wider debate and say, you know, have a relook at it, talk to and consult, and see if we can move forward in a different way. It's as simple as that.
Week that the department is now looking at the levy and that once
cabinet, or by cabinet on the 23rd of December. These are the draft budget proposals that are going towards our to meet the budget gap for 2021 budget. The report that comes to you on the agenda, it's in three sections. The first section really just gives you a bit of context about what the council's financial position is, and that's a direct lift from the cabinet report in December. Appendix 1 are the proposals that are relevant to the Business Scrutiny Committee, and then Appendix 2 is the full set of savings and pressures proposals that for the whole of the council. So what I was intending to do tonight, which I think is what the committee requested, is to go to Appendix 1, which is the individual specific proposals for Business Scrutiny, so for yourselves and members to scrutinise those. Is that okay? Okay. The first one is the new council model, which is a saving of £5 million. What this is really is it's made up of three different parts. At the moment, there is an ongoing review of council structures, and there is a full council-wide restructure review. So we're looking at all the structures that are in the council at the moment, and this is led by the chief executive. And we're just, each director is looking to see whether those structures are fit for purpose, whether they need to be redesigned, whether they need to be reviewed, to make sure that we can provide adequate services and give support to the residents and members going forward within those individual directorates. That's ongoing at the moment. As part of that, there's been three things that we are have done or that we are intending to do. The first thing is to call out for voluntary redundancy, which has already been taking place, and we have identified quite a few posts as a result of that. Second one is a full review of vacancies. So each director has been going through the vacancies in each of their areas to determine whether they are whether those posts need to be filled, or some of them have been vacant for a number of months or even a number of years in some cases, and which is taken out and not filled, or as part of the restructuring process, actually filled in a different way. What we do know is to do in this exercise is that where we have taken some vacancies out, we've identified growth in other areas, so we are moving posts fluidly around the council. So where we are making savings, or we can make savings in some area because posts are not needed. Some of that funding will be repurposed into other areas where we absolutely do need growth and reposting those areas. And the third thing, actually, relevant to the previous report, is using apprentices and graduates in a more innovative way. So some posts we find really hard to recruit, and these are specialist technical posts in some areas. So what we're planning to do is where people leave, where we are restructuring these teams, is actually bringing in apprentices and graduates rather than filling those posts, and building the talent within. So actually putting them on a formal training course, making sure that we've got proper training and development plans within the council, and providing them with a good succession training plan, so that when they have gone through the qualifications and they are qualified, then hopefully, you know, then they will stay within the council because they feel that they're a valued employee of the council, and that we can offer them sort of training and development as they go forward within their career. So all those three things really are going towards making up that saving of £5 million. So far, we have identified about £3 million of that, just from the things that I mentioned that we said that we've done already. What we are doing at the moment now is to say we're still ongoing with the restructuring process, so each directorate is still building their restructures, and we hope that we will find the other £2 million either from natural wastage, so people actually leaving, and then we can determine whether we need to replace those posts during the year or not, or further proposals of restructuring further down. So we're doing senior level restructuring at the moment. Once that's done, those senior managers who are in those posts will then be able to cascade it down to the bottom layers of the organisation. That's the intention for the £5 million. Do you want to take questions on each proposal as I go through?
Anybody got any questions or comments at this present time? Yes,
thank you. So you talked just finally then about how you might achieve those savings, but you didn't mention compulsory redundancies, and I'm thinking that that's not off the table.
There are no plans. We haven't identified any plans for any compulsory redundancies.
Okay, good.
Any more comments or questions?
reprofiling MRPV payment. So MRP is a technical term, it's called minimum revenue provision. And basically what it is every year we have to set aside a certain amount of money for the repayment of debt. So this is debt that we borrow. So I suppose in simple terms, it's like when you take out a mortgage, you have to set aside payments every year, every month for your mortgage payments. And this is what the council does, but it's called minimum revenue provision. We do this every year, we've been doing it for a number of years. It's statutory, we have to do it. What we've done is actually reprofiled the amount of money that we repay for this. So again, as you would potentially maybe extend your mortgage, or repay it early, or take on additional mortgage, council is able to do this with its debt. And what we've done is we have reprofiled the money we set aside for the repayment of that debt. So what that means is the future debt, we're paying less in the first 10 years and paying more in the latter 10 years. It's over 33 years. So we've just changed the way that we reprofile that funding going forward, that we're paying less in the first 10 years. Overall, over 33 years, it has no impact on the amount of debt that we repay. But legally, we are allowed to do this, and we have consulted with our